still expect GDP growth of approximately 6.5% for this year. At this point, we're probably a little bit shy of other more aggressive projections.
Of course, there's transient inflation. The important question is whether that is 6 percentage points of transient inflation or 4 percentage points.
There's upside risk to inflation. Could go higher than what I've outlined here. And we have to be ready on both sides.
You saw the reaction in the markets when the Fed just even hinted at tightening. I don't think they can tighten a lot without having a big negative effect.
This is Bloomberg Surveillance, Early Edition with Francine Lacqua.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition. I'm Francine Lacqua here in London, and here's what's coming up on today's program. At ease on inflation, Jay Powell reiterates he sees price increases as transitory as the Fed chair gets ready to testify before the House today. While Brent touches $75 a barrel, equities continue to rebound. Alarm bells. The former U.S. Treasury Secretary Larry Summers says he doesn't see why policymakers are so calm on inflation, as Ray Dalio warns that he doesn't think the Fed can tighten without a big negative effect. And Bitcoin slips towards $30,000 as China continues to crack down on cryptocurrencies. Former U.S. Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin says virtual currencies should be more transparent. So let's get straight to our top story. Jay Powell will tell Congress the economy is growing at a healthy clip, but unevenly. Let's get straight to our top story now. Jerome Powell saying this today, so let's get straight to our Danny Berger, actually, with the very latest. So, Danny, what are you looking at?
It's definitely this chop in markets, this back and forth, this yo-yo. It really is a market that's trying to wrap its head around exactly what we're getting out of the Fed. And because we have so many speakers, not just yesterday, but throughout the rest of the week, there seems to be this dissonance among them, which makes it difficult to get a really good read. But we're starting to see the session turn more negative as we continue throughout the day. But within that negativity, there is a clear theme, and it is that unwind of the reflation trade hit pause and is now reversing, more or less. You have some sellers still coming in at the 10-year. We have a yield flirting with 1.5%. It just hit that a moment ago as I was talking and is now back down. But in terms of stocks, you can see what's outperforming is the more cyclical ones in nature. We have a Dow Jones Future Index, which is trying so hard to be positive. So again, this is more those sort of reflationary stocks. Then, of course, we have Brent crude, which is dipping now under $75 a barrel after yesterday hitting that level, maintaining it for most of the morning. But as I say, we're getting more negative in terms of the tone in the market that's causing oil to fall.
Danny, we also get some, you know, bullish calls on oil. What are analysts actually saying?
Yeah, it looks like a Benjamin per barrel is kind of the high watermark of what we're hearing from analysts. Yesterday, Francisco Bland out of Bank of America, he says $100 a barrel of an oil. This isn't the first person to say it, but it reached this level yesterday after some of the more hawkish comments coming out of Bullard. But a lot of this does have to do with supply, this really restraint we're seeing from the U.S. shale patch and OPEC. And because of that, this key spread, this is the 3-4 month spread in WTI contracts, has gone into extreme backwardation. Every single time it's hit this in the past, it has reached $100 a barrel. So it's not crazy to have that estimate. Trafigura is one of the trading houses that has that estimate. I talked to the chief economist earlier today who says he think that triple digits could be reached next year, Francine.
Danny, thank you so much. Danny, I know you're also coming back to talk about Bitcoin, and then I need to ask about Bumble, actually, offering a week off for everyone. So that's a conversation Danny and I will have shortly. Joining us now to talk about the markets is Jane Foley, Rabobank head of FX strategy. Jane, what we're talking about Bumble is that actually they've given a week off to all of their employees to de-stress after COVID. So I don't know who needs it, but there are a couple of people in the newsroom that could also benefit from it. Jane, no matter, what are you looking at from Jay Powell today?
Well, you know, I think it's quite likely that he's going to push back perhaps at some of the hawkish rhetoric or some of the hawkish tone and or interpretations that we saw last week. So we've seen, you know, his prepared remarks. I think he's going to go back to this theme of inflation being transitory. But, you know, the cat is out of the bag. And, you know, if I might borrow a phrase from the minutes of the RBA meeting last week, it talked about a considerable amount of uncertainty whilst supply chain disruptions ease. And I think this is really something that the markets have been taking taking on board, which central bankers now, certainly the Fed, have been taking on board. We know that there a lot of inflation will be transitory, but, you know, semiconductor prices might come down eventually, but is it going to be 2 years, 3 years, 5 years? And this, of course, has the risk that it impacts inflation expectations, which central bankers really do have to be mindful of. So, yes, we might have a lot of transitory elements in inflation, but actually, before we get prices back to normal, central bankers might have to do a little bit of work to really keep a lid on inflation expectations. And I think Powell really does have to balance that in his comments today.
I mean, Jane, last week, of course, after the Fed decision, there was a huge repricing on the markets, really a lot of unwinding of the reflation trade. What's the next catalyst for example, dollar and some of these other currencies?
Well, you know, I think one of the themes that we've seen really emerging is does the Fed now, and particularly the movement higher in the dollar, does that make it easier for other central bankers to also become a little bit more hawkish? Now, there are certain contenders for that. I think the RBA is one. People are talking about the Bank of England perhaps as another, because, of course, we had that recent print of 2.1% on CPI inflation, and maybe even the ECB, because a lot of these central banks are looking at their currencies. They don't necessarily want a big spike in the value of their currency. So with the dollar already gone higher, perhaps they could afford to be a little bit more hawkish without really rocking the boat in terms of too much currency appreciation. So that's going to be interesting. I mean, with the Bank of England, I think it will be interesting to see if there's perhaps a little bit of a more hawkish take from some central bankers. Everyone knows, of course, Haldane is hawkish. I don't think the market's going to be surprised if he comes out with some hawkish remarks. But what about Freeher, for instance? Is he going to be a little bit more hawkish? He was a few weeks ago. What about other members? So I think over the summer, the markets are going to be really examining other G10 central banks more closely to see if there's been a shift in their degree of dovish versus hawkishness.
So what's your take on, is it actually sterling that you see the most value in at the moment, or what's your favorite G10 currency or favorite pair, I would say?
Well, to be honest, I have been waiting for the dollar to come back. I mean, it's gone a little bit faster than I had hoped, you know, or had anticipated. A week ago, I would have told you my 1 month forecast for it was euro dollar at was 120, and now we're at 119. My 6 month, I think I'll leave, it was 117. So I think the dollar strength will persist, even though I think we'll get some choppiness in the near term. I think the dollar strength will persist, certainly into Jackson Hole. I think the genie is out of the bottle with respect to the Fed now. The market is anticipating that they could be one of the first central banks, you know, maybe to move interest rates potentially as soon as 2022. So I think the dollar remains pretty firm now against a variety of other currencies. Will the Aussie dollar come back? Will the RBA become a little bit more hawkish this year? That's, I think, one to watch. I think with sterling, to be honest, I think cable is going to be moving around because of the dollar. Euro sterling is still, you know, really quite stable in a range here. So I think it's the central banks that have the potential to become a little bit more hawkish. I think it's those currencies that I'm going to be watching most.
Jane, Bitcoin also has slipped almost 10% over the past 3 days. Now, China's continued crackdown on cryptocurrencies is, of course, stoking fears of a deeper sell-off. Further regulation of the digital currencies will be a continuing litmus test for the industry. Now, we also spoke to the former Treasury Secretary, Steve Mnuchin, and he told David Westin at the Qatar Economic Forum that transaction should be more transparent. Here he is.
I believe that many of those industries should be in the regulated world. They should follow the same BSA, the Bank Secrecy Act requirements, know your customer requirements, and these shouldn't be the equivalent of secret Swiss numbered bank accounts. So as long as we do a lot of work, and that was being done at the G7 and G20 as well, I think the idea is to make sure we crack down on financial terrorism so it can't be used for ransom attacks and other illicit activities.
So, Jane, if you look at Bitcoin, it's around the $30,000 mark. What happens to Bitcoin from here? Is it more regulation? And is it especially just about China cracking down?
Well, China cracking down, certainly, but I think more regulation, I think that goes without saying. I mean, we can listen to Mnuchin and listen to what he's saying about cyber attacks and ransoms, et cetera. But I think there's another element here, and this is, again, coming back to inflation. Central banks like to have control of the money supply. They like to have control of credit creation via the commercial banks, et cetera. And if we move entirely to a crypto world, well, central banks lose control of that. Now, that's one of the reasons that crypto sector became popular in the aftermath of the global financial crisis. It was to move away from the banking sector. But central banks are unlikely to want that to happen, you know, without their control. So from that point of view, I think regulation is inevitable.
Jane, what happens? Is there Ethereum or something else that actually comes to take the place of Bitcoin? Or is it just not a category of cryptocurrencies that you want to be invested in right now? What is it actually?
I think that is something that is going to happen. I mean, I think we're going to have cryptocurrencies that are tied to other assets which central banks can have control of. I think this is probably the direction that we're going. But certainly if we listen to or read the reports of the likes of, say, the Riksbank that this year, they don't want this to happen too fast. This could be an enormous disruptive impulse into the commercial banking sector, for instance, through DeFi. And that is something which could be, you know, a huge shock to the economy. So this is something which is going to, I think, which central banks are going to allow to happen relatively slowly. But I think we are looking at a huge, huge shock to the financial sector.
Jane, thank you so much. Jane Foley there, Rabobank Head of FX Strategy. Now, coming up, we'll also be speaking to the New York Fed President, John Williams. Don't miss that exclusive interview at 2:30 p.m. UK time. It'll be really interesting to get his thoughts on inflation, transitory, and, of course, maybe some of the inflation imported or not from China. Up next, though, we get to the Qatar Economic Forum and hear exclusively from Alphabet's Chief Financial Officer, Ruth Porat, about Google's cloud business and the use of AI. That's next. This is Bloomberg. Finance, politics. This is Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition. I'm Francine Lacqua here in London. Now let's get straight to the Bloomberg First World News. Here's Leanne Gerrans. Hi, Leanne.
Hi, Francine. The U.S. says 150 million Americans, or over 45% of the population, have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. However, study reports the highly contagious Delta variant is spreading in southern states, which have lower inoculation rates than the rest of the country. India, meanwhile, vaccinated 8.5 million people yesterday, a new record high. Now, the UK has formally started negotiations to join a trans-Pacific trading bloc as part of its bid to diversify its commerce after leaving the European Union. International Trade Secretary Liz Truss says membership of the group, whose 11 members include Canada, Japan, Mexico and Australia, would be a glittering post-Brexit prize. Hong Kong's Apple Daily newspaper may be forced to shut down this week, with parent company Next Digital blocked by police from accessing its bank accounts. One of the most prominent voices of the city's pro-democracy movement, National Security Police arrested the paper's top editors last week. If funds do indeed remain frozen, a final print edition could be distributed this Saturday. Global news 24 hours a day, on air and on Bloomberg Quick Take, powered by more than 2,700 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Leanne Gerrans. This is Bloomberg. Francine.
Leanne, thank you so much. Now let's return to the Qatar Economic Forum, and the pandemic has accelerated the digitization of industry and the workplace. We spoke to the Alphabet Chief Financial Officer, Ruth Porat, about how Google was taking advantage of this opportunity. Now she spoke exclusively to Bloomberg's Eric Schatzker.
There has been a dramatic acceleration in the digital transformation. Trends that were playing out over a number of years have really been telescoped in, and you can see it in commerce, you can see it in content, entertainment, education, you can see it in telehealth, you can see it even in the way we're having this conference today and the way we all work. And I think one of the important points for everyone is that we don't see the clock turning back. We do see that these trends will continue to endure, and I think it's really important for each one of us to consider how we can embrace digital tools and technology to support both revenue opportunities and efficiencies in our own business. So, for example, and to your question, when we look at small, medium businesses, which are the backbone of economies, what we saw during the pandemic is one in three small businesses said they would not have survived if they did not have digital skills, because it enabled them to immediately pivot and find their customers where they were in the online world to get them the information they needed to talk about things like delivery or changed hours. And so these digital skills were absolutely imperative for survival.
The race, I would call it a race, to deepen relationships with customers and consumers is a fiercely competitive one. What is Google doing strategically or tactically, perhaps, that is different from what your competitors, the Microsofts, the Amazons, and the Facebooks are doing that you think ultimately is going to play to your advantage?
You know, one of the main things that we're focused on is how can we stay close to our users and customers and provide them with the tools and skills that they need to be most effective as the world continues to accelerate in this digital transformation. And our ability to leverage differentiated AI has been helpful for all of our customers, for users. You know, people don't even appreciate how often they're using AI in every day. So for those of you who are traveling around the world and opening up now to more travels, when you look at natural language translation, that benefits from AI. When you're asking the question of how do I get to find a store near me that's offering the services or products I want, again, we benefit from AI. So on the user side, really critical. On the enterprise side, what we're really excited about is the investments and opportunity in our cloud business. And our cloud business really is benefiting from extraordinary data analytics, the AI behind that, and then we've brought in talent to focus on very industry-specific solutions. So for example, in financial services, my old home, one of the key pain points was always the manual intensity around risk and risk analytics. We can leverage things like Know Your Customer or anti-money laundering with AI and data tools. So those are important, and we go to customers and it's like, here's how we can help either with revenue upside or efficiencies, leveraging the tools that we have. Same across retailers. They're looking at how can they ensure that they've got the best supply chain management when we've all lived through what we've seen. And so again, the benefit of AI. So we're looking across the board. I would say the other element of it is how can we be most supportive to the communities in which we operate? And part of that is ensuring that we're working around the globe to provide digital skills training to people so that everyone can participate in this rapid digital transformation.
That was the Alphabet Chief Financial Officer Ruth Porat speaking at the Qatar Economic Forum. Stay tuned, of course, for much more from the QEF. We'll be speaking this evening with the Glencore Chief Executive Officer, Ivan Glasenberg. I'll be doing that interview. We'll be talking about, of course, the commodity supercycle. We'll talk also about greening the economy. It's likely to be one of his final interviews in the role as he leaves on June 27th. And actually, it's one of the rare interviews that he's ever given in his tenure at Glencore. Now, also coming up, slow-going. Global financial hubs are struggling to return to the office. We take a look at the situation in different cities around the world. This is Bloomberg. Economics, finance, politics. This is Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition. I'm Francine Lacqua here in London. Now, let's focus on how the global return to the office is looking. 15 months after the first lockdowns, many of the world's key financial centers are struggling to kickstart the comeback. Now, from New York to Hong Kong, the picture, though, differs widely. With the details, Bloomberg's Stephen Ahrens joins us now from Frankfurt. Stephen, great to have you. And actually, it's a great, wonderful quick take. So how quickly are workers returning to the office?
Well, not very quickly. I mean, obviously, it's still very hard. Management want people back because it's just shown that if you keep people in the home office for too long, they lose productivity at some point. So they really want them to come back. But of course, there's really health hazards still, especially in Germany, where there's still a law until the end of this month that's actually prohibiting people to come back unless they're essential. And so that will be lifted at the end of the month. And things could change rather quickly over here.
So what is the biggest obstacle? Is it really vaccinations that will, I guess, force people back? I mean, do companies want to force employees back to the office if they don't want to go, or do they risk losing talent because of it?
I think those are the trade-offs that they're weighing at the moment, because they don't really want to force the people to come back when they feel unsafe. But yeah, as I said, they want to make sure productivity picks up again. And vaccination has been a problem because Germany is still lagging. The effort has been picking up over the past weeks and months even, but it's still behind the UK and the US. So that's another big problem. And the Delta variant that's so contagious and potentially more dangerous than other variants is starting to spread in Germany as well. That could be another obstacle.
So is there a city, is there a financial center, Stephen, that is doing much better than the others in terms of getting people back to the office?
Well, I think in the U.S. it's been doing pretty well. We've heard from several U.S. banks that they're actually demanding their people to come back rather quickly. That has not happened in Germany, for example. And the U.K. was pretty much ahead, too, until recently, until the Delta variant kicked in and hit the country pretty hard. There's now a delay and a similar prospect maybe facing Germany, actually.
Stephen, thanks so much. Stephen Ahrens there in Frankfurt. Now, you can read that full article on the Bloomberg Terminal. Just type NI Big Take. I mean, one of the questions that we've been also trying to figure out in the newsroom, looking at various asset managers, for example, BlackRock. Yesterday, we were speaking to the chairman, and we were talking about the fact that they ask their employees actually to disclose whether they're vaccinated or not, to say whether they come back. Is can a company force you to disclose whether you're vaccinated? I don't know the answer to that in different jurisdictions. So that's definitely something we'll dig deeper into. Coming up, some EU diplomats think there are too many British films and TV shows on the continent's streaming platforms. We'll be speaking to Heather Rabbatts, the chair of Garden Studios, a new film and TV studio space in London. This is Bloomberg. On inflation, Jay Powell reiterates he sees price increases as transitory as the Fed chair gets ready to testify before the House today. Brent touches $75 a barrel. Equities continue to rebound. Alarm bells. Former U.S. Treasury Secretary Larry Summers says he doesn't see why policymakers are so calm on inflation, as Ray Dalio warns that he doesn't think the Fed can tighten without a big negative effect. And Bitcoin slips towards $30,000 as China continues to crack down on cryptocurrencies. The former U.S. Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin says virtual currencies should be more transparent. Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Francine Lacqua here in London. Welcome to Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition on this Tuesday, the 22nd of June. Now, European equities are little changed this morning. Let's take a look at what's moving under the surface. Danny Berger has all of your stock market moves. So, Danny, what are you looking at?
I have a moving-related mover, if that makes sense. EasyJet. I'm trying to make this pun work. Going to force it through. EasyJet on the rise this morning, about 3% higher. The report out from the Times this morning saying that come Thursday, the UK government is likely to announce easing of some quarantine restrictions for British travelers who are fully vaccinated. I, for one, would love that, to be able to come back and not have to quarantine. British Land also rising today more than 4%. They're, of course, the real estate company. Reports on this one that they're selling off part of their Paddington Central Lands. I realize I'm doing a very UK-focused one to start here with, but Paddington Central property, it's in the center of London. It's a mixed-use space. It's very nice. It has a pergola. It has a bridge there. But anyway, reports are that they'd sell 50% of it, so that has the share price moving higher. And finally, Grand Vision. Now, they were supposed to be acquired by Luxottica, the big Italian eyewear company. They'd put a bid in, but an arbitration said that Luxottica doesn't have to go through with that acquisition and won't face a fine. The Italian company has been rethinking it because of the hit that the space has taken during the pandemic, Francine.
Danny, so I came in this morning, and this is how it happens in the morning. You kind of read stories, and then that's one that actually caught my attention last night, which
right.
is that Bumble is offering its staff a week off. And I immediately thought, I want to see what Danny thinks of it. So this is to retain staff, I imagine, because
yeah.
they call it, you know, COVID stress.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so my initial thought on this was like, okay, does Bumble shut down for a week? Is everyone who wants to online date going to be in absolute chaos? Of course it's not. But, you know, it's all these companies trying to find ways to help with burnout. But at the end of the day, I feel like a lot of people just want to be paid more. Maybe perks aren't really what matters. Maybe it's not a week off. They just want a better pay, Francine.
Yeah, I mean, maybe it's multiple choice. You know, you can have it. Yeah. Because you've had a stressful year, you can, A, have a week off
right.
to get a pay rate. What would you choose, Danny?
Can I get both? Is that an option?
Yeah.
No.
There you go.
You know what's kind of funny, Francine? Jeffries yesterday upgraded Bumble because more people are getting vaccinated. So more vaccination equals more dates equals more use of Bumble. I love that line of thinking.
Yeah, as well. And actually, if you invest in your employees, usually you get some good returns. That's, you know, not something you learn at the CFA, but it seems like just common sense. Danny,
yeah.
thank you. Danny Berger there with the very latest on the markets and also talent retention. Now, some EU union diplomats are said to have decided there are too many British films and TV shows on the continent's streaming platforms, threatening another valuable UK export in the wake of Brexit. For now, British shows are still treated as European, but if lawmakers tried to change Britain's status, it would put popular shows such as Doctor Who and Top Gear in direct competition with other global media for the remaining non-quota portion of Europe's content. Well, joining us now is Heather Rabbatts, chair of Garden Studios. Now, this is a new film and TV studio space in London. Heather is also the chair of Time's Up UK, which is a charity that insists on safe, fair, and dignified work for everyone. So thank you so much for joining us today. Heather, I have a lot of questions, of course, on diversity and the much-needed diversity questions that are in film. But first, let's start with Brexit. How much of a damage would it be to UK film production if actually the rules change on the quotas?
Yes, of course it would be damaging, and our relationship with Europe has been historically very strong and very collaborative in terms of how films and television series have been developed. I think we're all trying to grapple with a sort of post-Brexit universe, as well as, of course, the impact of COVID, which is shifting so many paradigms across different markets. So I'm sure we will all engage in as constructive a conversation as possible. But I think we shouldn't lose sight of that this is a global industry that, in terms of Garden Studios, as we are engaging in many discussions, whether it be with Netflix or with others, there just is huge interest from around the world in making shows in this country, as well as the fantastic talent that is based here.
Are we giving enough opportunity to emerging talent, to diversified talent, Heather? And actually, if we look at the last 14 months, has it made it easier or much more complicated for these, you know, very important but different voices to come at the forefront?
I think ensuring that our industry is diverse and inclusive is our number one priority. At Garden Studios, we house a film school, which has a whole range of students from around the world, and diversity sits at the heart of our educational endeavour and what we want to see play out at Garden Studios. Harnessing the voice of women, people of colour, is crucial to this industry, and we've begun to see breakthroughs with some of the talent that is emerging both here and globally, ensuring that those stories reflect the stories that come from all parts of humanity. We have to, though, really focus on this. We have to make sure that we improve the education, the training, the support, but also open up our industry to these new voices. And there are many initiatives underway with broadcasters, with production companies, to try and ensure that we really capture those voices going forward.
Heather, has it made it worse or easier in COVID, actually? I mean, we've had a lot of discussion about diversity and inclusion in the last 14 months. Does it translate into real action, or is it still just talk?
I think it's increasingly translated into action, and you can see that through, I mean, if you just look at the recent BAFTA winner, I May Destroy You, by Michaela Cole, I think you can see some of that talent breaking through. And there's increasingly encouragement by the broadcasters. We work very closely with the broadcasters as they open up their commissioning, as I said, to new voices. Now, there's still a long way to go. We absolutely have to stay really focused and energised around what we are doing. So I do think it's more than talk, but there's absolutely no room for complacency at this moment in time. It's like we've got green shoots coming through, and we need to really drive that growth now.
So where would the growth come from, Heather? Is it, you know, who's actually commissioning a lot of these films? I guess you always need backing, you need money for productions, and you need producers. Who do you think has more to spend and that really supports and champions some of these causes?
I think what's been interesting is how across the industry, whether you're talking the streamers or the traditional broadcasters, how they've all been now thinking about what they need to do. There are more new writer initiatives. There are new writers being commissioned in ways that we didn't see before. We've seen the rise of somebody like Emerald Fennell here, who obviously recently has got global recognition for her work. So I think it's about really working at those talent pipelines and ensuring in the commissioning of films and of television series that when you look across the slate, you can see that range of voices. And as I said, I think everybody is now very mindful about this. They're thinking about it. And we just have to ensure that we all encourage each other to keep on pushing so that we do get to a position of equity. We are still a long way away from that.
Thank you so much, Heather Rabbatts there, Garden Studios chair. Now, 500 million euros, that's how much Tikoho Capital's SPAC raised before listing in Amsterdam. It was the biggest such deal in Europe, and it had the support of Bernard Arnault and Jean-Pierre Mustier. Up next, we discuss with Tikoho's co-founder, Mathieu Chabran. If you have any questions for him, just IB plus TV Go. This is Bloomberg. Finance, politics, this is Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition. I'm Francine Lacqua here in London. Now let's talk about the SPAC space with our next guest. He's Mathieu Chabran, he's Tikoho Capital co-founder. Earlier in the year, Tikoho launched a blank check company alongside the billionaire CEO of LVMH, Bernard Arnault, and the former UniCredit chief executive, Jean-Pierre Mustier. Now, the resulting company was named Pegasus Acquisition and raised 500 million euros, making it the biggest such deal in Europe since the SPAC boom took off last year. Well, Mathieu Chabran, Tikoho Capital co-founder, joins us now. Welcome to Bloomberg, Mathieu, and for once, it's not in the middle of the night from New York, so I'm delighted for both you and me. Mathieu, when you look at the SPAC space and actually this big announcement that we talked about last time you were on, are you sooner to making an acquisition? How far away is that?
Yeah, thank you, Francine, for having us. Good, good morning. Pretty delighted, to update on this market, which, as you know, has been, fairly busy beginning of the year. Then, went a little bit quieter. There are a number of initiatives in the market, and looks like the market is finding now its equilibrium. So, as far as Pegasus is concerned, I would not comment much on potential acquisition, but what I can say is that on the back of this successful launch and successful pricing a couple of months ago, that has drawn a significant amount of interest, because as you remember, Francine, this is the first of its kind in the in Europe. Yeah. That was issued and priced a couple of months ago, and it's a very innovative technology for many companies who might be looking to access and tap the capital market, the public equity market, without going through, the traditional IPO route and getting the benefit of the SPAC. So it's very interesting and exciting, I should say, to be leading this this initiative here. As you remember, Pegasus is focusing on financial services with specific verticals on asset management, insurance, diversified financials, and as you very well know, it's a pretty busy market out there for this for this industry. So very excited to be taking that to the next phase.
But, Mathieu, can you give us an indication? I mean, the sector you've already chosen, you've highlighted, which is what you're, is it's in financial services. Would that be fair?
Yes, absolutely. That's what we said when we went public, that Pegasus has a publicly traded, blank check, as we call it, would be focusing on those, a specific sub-segment of the financial services. Again, asset management, insurance and insurtech, and diversified financials, which can be, SaaS, payment, distribution platforms. So very busy market out there, as I said, and it's a great alternative for many entrepreneurs, sometimes, about sellers, spin-off from larger conglomerate, financial services conglomerate, or from time to time, some sponsors looking to exit.
Mathieu, where do you still see value in the public markets from a PE fund perspective?
That's an interesting question, Francine, in the context of the close to all-time high valuation on many, across asset classes, I should say. But looking specifically at the at the public market, I mean, we passed, the 100 trillion, market cap, market capitalization, for the first time. I mean, we see all-time high, multiple on a PE basis. Here again, when it comes to SPAC, it's fairly different, because what we do, remember, we're not buying a company. It's not a buyout. We're not taking control. we're actually, you know, giving access to the public market to a privately owned company. So the convergence of this private market and public market effectively aim at getting the best execution by removing any kind of, you know, contingency in terms of pricing, in terms of market timing, and by having some kind of certainty of execution. So it's a very interesting dynamic, Francine, where you can effectively move away from the pure, you know, price focus and valuation that you can have nowadays by offering a very different, shading, you know, execution path and a runway, if I may say.
But so you extract value by a different execution path, which is, I mean, how different is it actually? Are there any specific things that you say, you know, I take this company, sure, it's valued at very high, but I can extract value this way to give me maximum returns very quickly? Or is it much more dangerous than 4 or 5 years ago?
Well, I mean, if we step back a minute, you know, for a privately owned company, you know, going public, you know, through a traditional IPO route, you know, you effectively face, you know, many risks, many uncertainties, and the first one is the price. You know, we may want to start, you know, looking at taking a company public today, you know, mid-June, and that will take place, you know, in December, 6 months down the road. So there is, you know, uncertainty on pricing and execution. The investors may or may not be there, you know, at the time, you know, you take the company public. With the SPAC route, you know, it's very different because the capital has been raised, so there is no uncertainty, you know, on the capital. And as long as you agree on valuation with the entrepreneurs, you know, the founder, again, I don't like to call them a seller because, once again, they're not selling the company. Well, it's not a buyout transaction. It's effectively, you know, converging and merging into the reverse merging into the listed entity. And that's where you can extract the value, Francine, because you're bringing, you know, first-class entrepreneurs, managers, leaders, the backing of some very high profile shareholders. You know, you mentioned some of the few in the sponsors, but we raised this 500 million capital base with top tier institutional investors. And that's a very appealing, differentiating proposal for the entrepreneurs. And then you can focus on extracting the value.
Mathieu, what's your take on asset management? So we've had so much consolidation actually in this space. Is it going to consolidate even more? Is there still going to be value created in Europe, or do you look elsewhere actually for asset managers to grow and consolidate further?
Yeah, I think we are, Francine, at a crossroad within the asset management world, and there is a, you know, there is a defining moment between the traditional asset management and the alternative asset management. The traditional asset management is effectively all about scale. I mean, I would not name them. I mean, we all have them in mind. You know, it's effectively about getting bigger, about, you know, managing the cost base, fighting the compression, you know, in margin and revenues. So it's a scale game. On the other hand, you've got the alternative asset management, which have been benefiting from massive structural tailwinds over the past 10 years. And it's a real, you know, it's a secular opportunity where you've got all those private markets, alternative private equity, private debt, real assets, infrastructure, you know, growing very strongly. And so I would really differentiate the traditional asset management space to the alternative. We tend to focus at TKO, and Pegasus might be more agnostic, you know, in the way it looks at it, you know, to the alternative space, which is not only a global opportunity as far as Europe, as you know, as you said, you know, massive consolidation opportunities. Sometimes the regulation is also a challenge, and that creates some subscale platform looking at, you know, merging or joining forces with a larger platform. So we should see more consolidation effectively, Francine, and it's a very interesting play at this time in the cycle.
Mathieu, thank you so much. Mathieu Chabran there, Tikehau Capital co-founder, stays with us, and we'll talk a little bit about aerospace. We'll talk also a little bit about sustainability. Up next, we continue our conversation with Mathieu Chabran. If you have any questions for him, just IB plus TV Go. This is Bloomberg.
We at Reliance have adopted this wholeheartedly and are transforming each one of our business lines to be sustainable, circular, recyclable, and with fully transparent environment, social, and governance standards. And I think that's a prerequisite for every business to survive as we go forward.
That was Reliance chairman and Asia's wealthiest person, Mukesh Ambani, speaking at Bloomberg's Qatar Economic Forum. Now, stay tuned for much more from the QEF. We'll be speaking this evening with the Glencore chief executive, Ivan Glasenberg, in what's likely to be one of his final interviews in the role at Glencore as he steps down on June 27th. Now, my conversation actually with Ivan will really focus, and I know it will be pretty feisty and explosive, about the energy transition. So let's get back to Mathieu Chabran, Tikoho Capital co-founder, also to talk about the energy transition. Mathieu, when you look at the energy transition, I know you've actually been more involved in trying to find companies. I don't know whether it's technology or just that help with carbon offsets, but how do you see that developing, and is it one of the most exciting industries out there?
It is definitely exciting. You know, Francine, if you let me paraphrase Mr. Ambani, what he just said, you know, basically today, companies have to be sustainable to be profitable. And that is the new paradigm. You cannot escape that. All the stakeholders, you know, be shareholders, lenders, investors, customers, states, there will be no place to hide. So, you know, this opportunity is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. There are some very ambitious goals that have been set by 2030. So very exciting. And, you know, there's been many initiatives announced, launched since we last talked, Francine, on your show. There is, you know, no shortage of capital. It's really about directing efficiently this capital. And this energy transition opportunity, you know, is one that no one can shy away from.
But Mathieu, where exactly do you invest? So, you know, we've all been learning a lot about these new technologies, about even battery storage. How do you find the right one that will then be adopted more than, you know, some of the other solutions?
Low carbon mobility, you know, is one effectively, and it goes beyond the EVs and the electrical batteries. It's about energy, you know, building efficiencies. Bear in mind that, you know, real estate, I mean, buildings are one of the largest GHG greenhouse gases emission cause. It's about, obviously, you know, renewable production, but it's really about, you know, embedding technology to effectively get to these goals. Because keep in mind that if you want to meet the Paris Agreement goals, we have to come back to the emission level that was, you know, the 70s. And, you know, we shouldn't be scared about that, because in the 70s, we didn't have all these technology elements that we can factor in, you know, for all these challenges. So what we focus on through this fund, first in Europe, and now we announced a similar strategy for North America, for the US, is really the mid-cap profitable company that we want to take to the industrial phase. So we're not investing in early stage in R&D or venture type of company. There is a proof of concept, and you need to take them, you know, to scale. And that's a great opportunity in itself. Obviously, the U.S. administration have stated some very ambitious goals here. So it's great that, you know, here, Europe, and hopefully with the France leadership and the Paris Agreement together with the U.S. are converging on this goal, which is, once again, you know, a massive goal that collectively should aim for.
Mathieu, thank you so much. We'll also get you back also to talk about your renewed commitment to some of the aerospace sector. Mathieu Chabran there, Tikoho Capital co-founder. Well, Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition continues in the next hour. Matt Miller joins me out of Berlin, Kailey Leinz out of New York, and this is Bloomberg.
We still expect GDP growth of approximately 6.5% for this year. At this point, we're probably a little bit shy of other more aggressive projections.
There's upside risk to inflation, could go higher than what I've outlined here. And we have to be ready on both sides.
You saw the reaction in the markets when the Fed just even hinted at tightening. I don't think they can tighten a lot without having a big negative effect.
This is Bloomberg Surveillance, Early Edition, with Francine Lacqua, Matt Miller, and Kailey Leinz.
It's 10 a.m. here in London, 11 a.m. in Berlin, 5 a.m. in New York, and 5 p.m. in Hong Kong on Tuesday, June the 22nd. Our top stories today. At ease on inflation, Jay Powell reiterates he sees price increases as transitory as the Fed chair gets ready to testify before the House today. Bitcoin slips towards $30,000 as China continues to crack down on cryptocurrencies. And return to the work, well, or to work, the world's financial centers are struggling to get people back in the building. Kailey, there's also this great story actually about Bumble giving a free week's holiday just because of COVID stress. So it'll be interesting to see this talent for, you know, this war on talent with companies trying to figure out exactly what perks they can give people to retain them. But never matter, the markets are looking at Jay Powell and inflation.
Well, now I'm just standing here, Francine, wondering how I can get a free week off. But yes, you're exactly right. Focused on inflation, focused on all of the Fed speak we're getting this week, including Jerome Powell testifying in Congress today. Now, I would note in the Asian session, we did see a good deal of catching up to the gains we saw in the U.S. yesterday. Broadly positive, albeit the Hang Seng was slightly lower, about down about 0.6 on the day. But Chinese equities were higher, and Japanese equities recovered almost all of their losses yesterday, down 3.3% in the Monday session, up 3.1% today. Speaking of Japanese assets, I would note that the yen is weaker against the U.S. dollar. It is above that 110 level still. And I wanted to note in the Asian bond market, investment grade dollar bond spreads tightening for a ninth straight day as investors are looking for some safety there. We're now sitting just around 130 basis points. Also, I have to put on my Asia board again, Bitcoin, because it is concerns about a cryptocurrency crackdown in China that continue to weigh on that market. Bitcoin right now down below $32,000, getting closer and closer to that $30,000 level. As for what the picture looks like here in the U.S., we did see that rebound, that recovery in the reflation trade taking place yesterday. We aren't seeing really strong follow through on that today, though. Futures pointing to a bit of a weaker open. We're down about 5 points on S&P 500 E-minis at the moment. In the bond market, we saw a massive intraday move on the 10-year Treasury yield yesterday, swinging more than 10 basis points. It did end the day around 1.49%, and we're effectively unchanged at that level right now. It is a story of broad dollar strength today after weakness yesterday, and that dollar strength may be part of what is weighing on crude. WTI futures now down about 0.75%, still holding above $73 a barrel. And of course, Matt, that is after Brent crossed above $75 a barrel, though it is off those levels now.
Yeah, Brent, the global benchmark, and people are now calling for $100 barrels in the next 12 to 18 months. Let's take a look at European markets right now. We see a little bit of a mixed picture once again. The FTSE is doing well. The continental index is not so much. You can see very little change there in France, but Italy is down and Ireland is up. More interestingly, maybe we see a climb again in bonds right now. Those negative yields are getting closer to zero, right around negative 15 basis points. You can see the pound also falling against the dollar. Everything's falling against the dollar, but the pound is a bigger fall in terms of standard deviation moves than the euro. I find it very interesting, this back and forth. You know, as the Fed takes a hawkish pivot, can other central banks demur and keep their currency advantage or increase their currency advantage to boost exports? It's something they don't usually talk about, but maybe they want to do. And then lean hogs, something that we haven't talked about, focused on too much, but I mentioned it a couple times in the past few sessions because this really shows that maybe inflation is rolling over. We're seeing prices for goods, especially goods that are vital to our lives, like pork is to me, come down a little bit. So it looks like maybe the Fed was right in terms of transitory. Francine?
Live hogs. I love it. But if you look at avocados, Matt, they went up like they quadrupled.
Right? I don't eat avocados.
In the last 12 months. There you go. I don't want your diet, Matt, I think is
problem solved.
It's something that maybe we need to work on. We're watching inflation through
Matt
Miller's diet.
That's what my wife
says. Not as high as every other diet in the world, especially at our age, Matt. We'll chat off air about that. Now look at what else is coming up this week or today as well. New York City heads to the polls today to vote in the Democratic mayoral primary. Now election officials say it will be at least a week until the winner is known. So that's a big one. Lots of Fed speakers today as well. It kicks off with the Cleveland Fed president, Loretta Mester, discussing financial stability at 10:30 a.m. Eastern time. San Francisco Mary Daly speaks at 11 a.m. Then the key one to watch, the Fed chair, Jay Powell, testifies to a congressional committee at 2 p.m. New York time. That's what Matt and I were just talking about. His prepared remarks are already catching attention. He's due to say that inflation has picked up but should move back towards the Fed's 2% target. Now let's get more, of course, on what we've been hearing from the Federal Reserve with Bloomberg's Danny Berger. Danny, it's definitely, there's one game in town. It's the Fed and Jay Powell, and it's moved the markets for the last 7 days.
It really has, and it's a yo-yo market at this point now, really, because the market is trying to decide what is the narrative coming out of the Fed. Is it this hawkish pivot, or is it more like John Williams talked about yesterday, the need to proceed with more caution, that we're still not in the all clear. And that's certainly some of the commentary coming out of Powell's prepared remarks, continuing to hit that temporary inflation kind of drumbeat. But it also becomes difficult just to glob onto those when you also have speakers like Bullard and Kaplan, for example, again, sounding more hawkish, wanting to taper sooner. So this is what the market is confronted with. And we have more than a dozen speakers to go for the rest of the week. So this theme of dissonance among Fed members might be really the prevailing one. And as our colleague Mark Cudmore says, that might be what they want. They might want that dissonance, Matt, because it means that they have more flexibility in which direction they go if it's not necessarily a straight down the line communication. Exactly. They want that optionality.
Well, and Danny, of course, as we try to digest what each and every Fed speaker is saying, it's a lot of potential catalysts. What's it all going to mean for the bond market?
That is a fantastic question. Well, I think for the moment at the bond market, the big question lingering over it is whether that flattening trade is going to resume. Now, if you're JP Morgan, you look at this and you say what it means for the bond market is basically nothing, that nothing has changed post this FOMC. And because of those flattening trades we saw put on, because of that reflationary trade which backed off, it's a good opportunity to go back in and bet that that reflationary trade can continue.
Danny, thank you so much. So much going on with the Fed. All eyes on inflation. I feel like I've been saying that for the last 4 months. For the next 10 months, it'll still be all eyes on inflation. We'll be watching, of course. We'll be all over inflation with that Jay Powell testimony at 2 p.m. Eastern time. Now, Bitcoin fluctuating today, the largest cryptocurrency continuing to be under pressure amid a crackdown in China on payment services and mining operations. Let's get more with Bloomberg's MLive managing editor, Mark Cudmore. Mark, is there a target, and I know this is a very controversial question, but is there a target that actually China wants to get Bitcoin to so it's no longer viable?
I don't think there's necessarily a specific target, and I do think that, as you kind of imply, any specific targets in Bitcoin are a little bit arbitrary. But I think there are two, you know, facets to their attack on Bitcoin. One is we know they're very concerned about financial market risks, and obviously they want to be able to monitor Bitcoin payments, and they want to make sure that people aren't using cryptocurrencies to get money out of the country. So that's one facet of their targeting of Bitcoin. The other one is the fact that China has set itself some very ambitious climate goals, and therefore, and you know, they have a quite nuanced perspective around this. But when they've got a certain industry which is using an exceptional amount of energy for no real economic gain for the country, it's an easy place to target. So I think the climate motive and the financial risks mean they're going to keep the pressure on Bitcoin for the foreseeable future.
By the way, I cut and pasted a piece of your macro view today, Mark. I thought it was fantastic when you pointed out that this allows the Fed move allows other central banks to get more hawkish. And indeed, we've seen that, and that's going to be a marginal move higher or tighter in terms of global liquidity, and it's going to hurt maybe cryptos and meme stocks, although meme stocks, maybe they're immune to that kind of move. I want to ask, though, about oil. We see Brent touching 75, breaking through, coming back down. But I heard a call this morning that we could see $100 oil in 12 to 18 months. What do you think of this supply side issue?
So I think there's two kind of different dynamics here. One is I do find that the whole oil market has this default to just get super bullish oil at the highs. And I always get a little bit cynical when I hear these grandiose calls to the market, because there is an immense amount of supply out there that can come on the market very quickly, both from OPEC Plus and from shale suppliers who've been very restrained so far in terms of increasing their drilling. Now, the more the price goes up, the more the incentive is for them to actually increase supply. So I get a little bit worried about that. However, one thing I'll say is that I do think that the longer-term future of oil prices, and maybe I'm getting too far ahead of myself here, is going to be more similar to coal prices over the last decade. As we want to move to a greener future, we're going to invest less in kind of new supply, and that means we're going to get some really, really powerful spikes at times when the market can't react quickly enough. People thought that coal was a dying market 10, 15 years ago, but we continue to see coal just surging and having these crazy rallies every so often just because that supply doesn't react. And I can see that being the story for oil. Do we get to $100 a barrel later this year? Sounds punchy to me, given that shale supply can switch on very quickly. But I guess it looks like we're still going higher in the short term because those inventories are low.
All right, Bloomberg MLive Managing Editor Mark Cudmore with the short-term and long-term view for us. Thank you so much. Now, I do want to take a quick look at some stocks moving in pre-market trading in the U.S., and one of them is a tiny oil player, Torchlight Energy Resources. This is one of the latest in the craze of meme stocks. Already, as of yesterday's close, it was up 130% in a week, and we are adding to those gains this morning, up about 12.5% in early hours after getting touted on Reddit as a potential short squeeze. One of the older meme stocks, though, that seems to be falling out of favor is AMC. It looks set for a third consecutive day of losses, down 6% yesterday and off another 2% in early hours this morning. And another stock moving to the downside is Microvision after it announced a $140 million at-the-market equity facility after the bell yesterday. Investors not really liking that. That stock down about 9% before the bell, Francine.
Yeah, so much going on. Microvision. You know, stock that we'll talk a lot more about during the day. Now, coming up next, Ian Shepherdson, Pantheon Macroeconomics Chief Economist, will talk not about copy and paste, although I want to quiz Matt Miller about his copy and paste, things instead of doing screen grabs, but we'll talk about inflation with Ian. This is Bloomberg.
Would be healthier, again, as we're making progress in weathering the pandemic and achieving our goals, to start adjusting these purchases, treasuries and mortgage-backed securities, sooner rather than later.
There's upside risk to inflation, could go higher than what I've outlined here. And we have to be ready on both sides, I think, to be able to react to that.
Much of the consensus of professional economic forecasters in February was that we would have inflation just above 2% this year. We've already had more inflation than that in the first 5 months of the year.
It's easy to say that the Fed should tighten, and I think that they should, but I think you'll see a very sensitive market and a very sensitive economy because the duration of assets has gone very, very long.
There are a few voices calling for the Fed to be more attuned to inflation risks, including some from the Fed itself. Joining us now is Ian Shepherdson, founder and chief economist at Pantheon Macroeconomics. Ian, is this, I mean, we're headed in that direction, right? A body in motion stays in motion unless, I guess, countered by an opposing force. I can't remember the exact Newton quote, but it looks like we're on the road, right? So what do you do?
Well, we're going to stay on this road. The timing is everything, of course, you know, in markets as well as comedy. And the problem is that markets, I think, are rather more impatient than Chair Powell is willing to be. What really struck me last week was how keen he was to point out the limits of his knowledge and the Fed's knowledge and all economists' knowledge and say, look, we don't know what's going to happen because we've got no precedent for anything like this. So we have to be patient. We have to wait and see how the labor market in particular evolves in response to this spike in inflation, whether it becomes embedded through faster wage growth. And if it does, then we can respond to it in due course. And markets for now seem willing to buy that idea. There are, as you just played earlier, a bunch of dissenting and more aggressive voices out there. But I think that I think Powell's approach for now is reasonable, that we just don't know. The unknowns are greater than the knowns. Having said that, I do buy the idea that we need to separate, draw a distinction between the slowdown in asset purchases, the tapering, and the eventual rate hikes which have to come at some point in the future. Because I do think that almost regardless of the inflation picture in the next 6 to 12 months, tapering is necessary because this economy to me doesn't need $120 billion of Fed money every month anymore. I think that time has passed.
Ian, are you really back at Pantheon Towers? Like, are you back in the office? And does that make people less productive?
Yes.
And does that matter to the Fed?
I'm more productive in the office, especially today because the piano tuner's at home. But yes, the move back into the office is very significant. I'm expecting it to accelerate over the summer. You know, pretty much all the people I'm talking to, all my clients are talking about being fully back in over the summer and into the fall and good to go. And I think that's kind of a line that I would take for the whole economy as well, that the reopening is not complete yet. It's underway, and in some sectors it's really very, very rapid. But I think we're going to see a much more complete story by the end of the summer. And that will give us really critically important news on what happens in the labor market when the economy is fully reopened, because nothing is more important than how many of the missing millions from the labor force come back in, because if they don't, then we're going to have a wage inflation problem, and the Fed will be tightening not in 2023, but in 2022.
Right.
If those people do come back in and labor supply rises and it meets the demand, then we'll have a very different story. But I think what Chair Powell keeps telling us is, look, we have to wait because we don't know. And pretending that we know doesn't get us anywhere. We just have to wait.
Yeah, the question of how difficult it is going to be to get back to full employment certainly looms large. Aside from the Fed, what about other central banks? Has the Fed given them potentially more clearance to be hawkish?
Oh, I think so. I mean, the Fed actions give cover to pretty much everybody. That's kind of the way I would look at it from a UK European perspective. From the perspective of emerging markets, it's not so much that the Fed gives you cover, it's that the Fed puts you under pressure. Because once the Fed starts talking about tightening policy or just becoming a bit less accommodative, then everybody starts to focus much more closely on what EM's doing and where the vulnerabilities are. So it kind of depends where you sit. If you're sat in an EM central bank, then the Fed saying, hey, we're thinking about a change, you know, that's bad news. But if you're in Europe or in the UK, it gives you a bit of breathing room. It allows you to talk a bit more hawkishly. But again, even in those other developed economies, this question about labor market uncertainty is going to become paramount within the next few months. And just like in the US, they don't know either. So there's no great rush anywhere to jump onto the tightening bandwagon or even onto the less accommodative bandwagon. But there's no question that there is now an opening in the door that wasn't there a couple of weeks ago.
Ian, thank you so much. We've opened a Pandora box. We're three anchors, Ian. One actually says he's more productive from home. It's the other from the office. So I don't know. We'll have to debate this. I don't know where I'm productive. Maybe I'm never productive, Ian. Is that? I'm like, you know, I'm baffling to economists. Ian Shepherdson, founder and chief economist at Pantheon Macroeconomics. Now, coming up, we'll get the view on inflation from New York Fed President John Williams. That exclusive interview is at 9:30 a.m. in New York, 2:30 p.m. in London. And this is Bloomberg.
This is Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition. I'm Kailey Leinz in New York with Francine Lacqua in London and Matt Miller in Berlin. Now let's get the first word news. And the U.S. says 150 million Americans, or over 45% of the population, have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. However, a study reports the highly contagious Delta variant is spreading in southern states, which have lower inoculation rates than the rest of the country. India, meanwhile, vaccinated 8.5 million people yesterday, a new record. The UK has formally started negotiations to join a Trans-Pacific trading bloc as part of its bid to diversify its commerce after leaving the European Union. International Trade Secretary Liz Truss says membership of the group, whose 11 members include Canada, Japan, Mexico, and Australia, would be a glittering post-Brexit prize. With pandemic restrictions now being lifted across the country, companies are taking different approaches to retain staff and boost productivity. Some expect a full return to the office, while others are being flexible. Companies like Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan are requiring all vaccinated employees to be back at their desks this fall, whereas Apple and others plan a hybrid work-from-home strategy. Dating app Bumble temporarily closed this week, giving its workers a, quote, much-needed break to recover from COVID-19 burnout. And the company behind Soho House, a members club for creative industry executives, has filed for an IPO in New York. Membership Collective Group owns 28 clubs and 9 workspaces around the world, including the Ned, a vast hotel complex in the city of London. The company, which is yet to make a profit, says it plans to use the IPO proceeds to pay down some of its more than $800 million of debt. And I just found out I am officially the least cool member of Team Surveillance Early Edition, because both Matt and Francine are Soho House members, and I am not. Matt, can I get a referral?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, you would be a way cooler member than either one. Soho House would much prefer to have you as a member than either myself or Francine. So maybe we'll just transfer our memberships to you. You know, the cool thing is, so members can buy, or the uncool thing, members can buy shares, but they can't, but you can't if you're not in America. If you don't live in America or the UK, you can't buy shares, so I'm out.
Speak for yourself. You can transfer your membership. Kailey and I will go. The problem, Kailey, is that you can't find a table anywhere to the cool places. So actually, I hope their IPO is more successful than their booking system, is all I will say. Coming up, Thanos Papasavvas from AVP. This is Bloomberg. This is Bloomberg Surveillance Early Edition. I'm Francine Lacqua in London, Matt Miller in Berlin, Kailey Leinz in New York. Now, a lot going on. We haven't even talked about Bumble, Matt, actually offering employees a week off because of the stress they've had to deal with in COVID. I don't know whether that's because they worried about, you know, losing their employees, but we also have a big take, which is fantastic, looking at the different financial centers and what banks are trying to do to get people back in the office and retain talent.
Yeah. It wasn't very stressful for me, I have to say. I think I chose the perfect time to have a baby because I can't go out and do anything anyway. So I found it pretty relaxing.
Matt Miller.
Berlin's fairly empty. No one else is in the office, you know?
Yeah, I've had to homeschool. Kailey, I mean, you've been coping okay.
Yeah, and I've also been in the office pretty much the whole time, barring 2 weeks in April of last year. But Matt Miller, always just more chill than I am, Francine, I have to say. Let's talk about the markets, though. Pivoting from this conversation, of course, we did see a rebound in the reflation trade yesterday. It does seem that maybe some of those reflation trades will be outperforming again today, but we aren't seeing that lift continuing in the broader equity markets. In Europe, the stock 600 down by about 0.1%. And here in the U.S., with about 4 hours to go until the opening bell, futures are in red territory. We're down less than 2 points on S&P E-minis, but still not a gain that we're looking at. In the bond market, we saw that wild swing yesterday, more than 10 basis points intraday on the U.S. 10-year yield. Right now, we're basically unchanged, just shy of the 1.49% level. And I have to note Brent as well, because earlier it was making headlines for crossing above $75 a barrel. It has dipped back below that now, trading at $74.42. A stronger dollar may have a little bit of something to do with that. Also, it didn't fit on my board, but Bitcoin is heading down toward $31,000 today. Concern about mining crackdowns in China, and that is weighing on some crypto-tied stocks in pre-market trading. Marathon Digital down about 2%, as is Riot Blockchain. And, of course, we have to mention some meme stocks as well. The latest in the fad is Torchlight Energy, up 130% over the last week, looking set to add to those gains come the opening bell. It's up about 14% in early hours, and Context Logic is higher by about 3.3%, Matt.
All right, well, we're watching Bitcoin very closely because it'll be interesting to see, Kailey, if it hits 30,000 and bounces off or if it breaks through and that's then a trigger to sell. It's very technical and there's not a lot of fundamental. I'm not sure how much the Chinese mining crackdown really is moving it, and it's not just a little bit of a momentum issue. I have something that may play into a Bitcoin reflation, or certainly into risk asset reflation, from David Kostin and his team at Goldman Sachs. For those of us, for those of you, I should say, listening on radio, typically I'm a radio listener. I much prefer it to television, but we have charts on television that you can't see on radio. And this one is really good. Dan Curtis put this together for me from our production team in New York. And as I said, it comes from data out of Goldman Sachs. The blue line here shows share buybacks in the S&P 500. Remember how big share buybacks were driving the market through 2018? And then they just kind of fell off, not a cliff, but rolled over a hill and really dropped down in terms of a market driver. The white line here is cash on the sidelines, and this is just amazing, climbing higher and higher, in this case represented by money market fund assets at more than $4.5 trillion. Kostin and Goldman Sachs say there's more than $5.5 trillion of cash on the sidelines, and that $500 billion of that is going to go back into risk assets, back into the stock market through year end. The majority of it, Goldman Sachs says, through corporate buybacks. So Thanos Papasavvas joins us, CIO and founder at ABP Invest. And Thanos, I just want to ask, you know, is this enough to drive the market higher? Because so far, year to date, we've only had, well, less than $200 billion in corporate buybacks. If we get another half a trillion, does that mean we're off to the races again?
Well, I think the market will be, good morning, Matt, by the way. I think the market will be focusing a little bit more on any potential trajectory changes in the Fed and any potential risk of financial conditions tightening later on this year and early this year. So I think that will probably have priority in terms of the markets. And also, if we look at other levels of indications, such as margin debt or levels of margin debt and valuations, they still tend to be quite elevated. So I wouldn't be as positive as that.
So what do you think we're going to take from the Fed then? I mean, even if the tone turns a bit hawkish, they're still buying $120 billion a month, and that doesn't look to slow down anytime soon, regardless of what Kaplan has to say. Do the markets take solace in the fact that the Fed is still there, at least through, you know, 2022?
Yeah, I think what we saw since the Fed statement last week was a relief rally. In essence, the market felt relieved that the Fed is not stubborn, is aware, maybe a little bit behind the curve, but certainly there to take action as the underlying data changes. And our view, Matt, is that we are not in a temporary or a transitionary phase of inflation. We believe that inflation is here, is coming back. We're not going to have an inflationary crisis like back in the 1970s because we have the tools and the credibility to deal with that. But still, we're going to have elevated levels of inflation, especially in the US and then followed by the UK. So I think that the Fed will gradually start shifting its trajectory very close to the end of this year and early start of next year as all cylinders start working in the U.S. economy in Q3, Q4.
But Thanos, are markets just buying time to see fundamentals? And so do they want to know what kind of inflation we're looking at, or they're just waiting for indication for the Fed of what they'll do next?
No, I think the markets don't believe that we're going to be having an inflationary issue. I think the markets are basically saying, well, we had so much money being thrown at us after the global financial crisis. We have the same demographic issues. You know, technology prices go down. I don't think the markets believe in inflation. I think that's the reason.
But Thanos, there has been a pretty aggressive repricing over the last 7 days. So if they don't believe in the reflation story, what are they believing in?
No, I think they're seeing it more as a transitory, temporary, rather than a longer term issue. Whereas in my view, Francine, is that we are going to see the yield starting to rise, but in a gradual trajectory. And I think this will be the driver for the Fed to see how does it move away from the $120 billion a month. So I think the Fed will be first seeing to see if the trajectory is gradual and an orderly increase in yields, then it'll be able to take some foot off the gas.
Well, of course, Thanos, one of the factors contributing to these inflationary pressures has been higher commodity prices. And that is a story that is starting to change. What do you make of that?
Well, Kelly, we had been positive on copper from last May 2020. And reflation story, strong growth story, stimulus, China. And also later on in the year, ESG factors, the infrastructure spend and the shifts towards sort of solar. But during the last month, we realized that everything that we had been calling for was already in the price, in the market. So we downgraded our view on copper. We moved it to neutral. We did the same with oil. So I believe that, yes, we are in a commodity sort of strengthening period, but I don't expect the same sort of rallies as we have seen recently. We are already expecting that. It's in the price.
Does that same thesis apply to other cyclical assets in the equity market, for example?
Well, in the equity markets, our view has been to be neutral in the U.S. and more positive outside of the U.S. So we like Europe from a valuation point of view. We like the U.K. We continue to like China, an equity view we have held consistently since 2018. And within the U.S. market, we recently wrote some analysis about a shift from growth to value, partly because of the higher yields we expect, partly because of the higher inflation, and also an uptick in terms of overall levels of growth. So I think all of these factors will be shifting growth towards value within the U.S. market, but overall neutral U.S. versus others, European and global.
Thoughts on the car makers, Thanos? Always interested to know what people think about Volkswagen, BMW, Ford, General Motors, Tesla.
Unfortunately, I'll disappoint you on that. Unfortunately, Matt, no particular view on a bottom-up particular corporates themselves. But as a reflation, as a strengthening trade, I think that's important. Also, in my view, although there are Sino-US tensions which will continue, I think that the European relations with China will continue to be more constructive than what potentially President Biden would have liked. So I think this is unlikely to dampen the export-import relations between China and the Europe.
Thanos, what about tensions in cryptocurrencies? Are you fully invested in Bitcoin?
No, I'm not, Francine, for a very, very simple reason. It's that we would have liked to see what Bitcoin does over an economic cycle, over a business cycle, to see correlations, whether it's with growth, with inflation, with other asset classes. I can see why people choose to allocate some portion of their assets in that. It's on the back of price. But in terms of valuations and fundamentals, we have not seen it through a cycle. So we're sort of stepping back, waiting to see how that pans through and consider it over the next economic cycle or two.
All right, Thanos, thank you so much. I think Matt Miller was briefly a billionaire because of Bitcoin, but no longer. Thanos Papasavvas, their chief investment officer and founder at APP Invest. Now, coming up, global financial hubs are struggling to return to the office. We'll take a look at the situation in different cities around the world. That's coming up next, and this is Bloomberg.
If you want to have sustainable growth, it must be inclusive growth. It's not just the right thing to do, but it supports economic growth for the long term. And so one of the areas that we've been very focused on, as I've already noted, is ensuring that everyone has equal access to the opportunities for jobs of the future, the jobs of today and the future. And those are going to be digital based.
That's the Alphabet, Google. A lot of people still call it Google. Chief Financial Officer Ruth Porat speaking at the Qatar Economic Forum. Now, 15 months after lockdown to ward off COVID-19, some of the world's key financial centers are struggling to get employees back to the office. Well, with more on this wonderful big take story from Frankfurt is Bloomberg's Stephen Ahrens, who helped write the story. Stephen, thank you for joining us. Now, we talk about this day in, day out. Different people are going to different speeds. There's a clear message from top chief executives saying, to preserve culture, I want people back in the office. Is it working?
Yeah, well, it's, as you said, it's working at different speeds. Clearly, executives want their staff back in the office, but they can't change the facts on the ground, the pandemic facts on the ground. If the pandemic is still there, then they have to contend with that. And so we've seen places like in Asia, Hong Kong and Singapore, which have been more successful returning people to the office than the U.S. and certainly Europe, Germany, where I'm at present. It's been lagging.
It's interesting that there was a UBS study out showing that 88% of executives want their employees back in the office, but only 40% really think it's about preserving the culture. They just want to get those bodies back because they don't believe you're doing as much work at home. Isn't that the case, Stephen?
I don't think so, to be very honest. I do think people have been seeing that working from home does preserve productivity to a certain degree, but at some point, if people are only working from home, it does erode. So they want people to come back to spend some time together, just to, you know, to feel the office culture. Also, I think it's important to actually see clients again. That's an important point. It's not just the office, it's traveling too. Meeting clients, winning the pitch in person rather than by Zoom. Those are important considerations, even for the executives.
What about the talent retention consideration? If you have one job potentially being offered to you that is going to allow you to be flexible to work from home, and the place you're working now says, no, you have to be in the office 5 days a week, doesn't that create a bit of an issue?
It's a tricky question. I guess when you're a junior, when you're, for example, a recent graduate and you're looking at your first job, I think you do want to spend some time in the office because it's very hard, actually, to get to meet people, even your own colleagues from home. It's very hard to learn about the office culture when you're working from home. So I think most graduates are actually quite eager to go to the office. Whether they're comfortable working there 5 days a week, that's another question. But I do think banks are trying, at least companies generally, banks are trying to offer a certain degree of flexibility, but I think they want people, especially junior ones, to come in.
By the way, a lot of banking stories today, Steve. Yesterday we saw HSBC wants to revamp its U.S. investment bank. They're hiring 50 new employees there. What's the story with HSBC coming back on the IB side in the U.S.? They just pulled out of consumer banking, right?
That's right. They're trying to sell a lot of retail business. They just offloaded the French retail business to Cerberus. They're also trying to figure out what to do with their U.S. retail business, but they are trying to maintain a strong investment bank. It's a bank under reconstruction. It's going through a big, ambitious turnaround program right now. I think the question what they will do with the investment bank and whether that effort will be successful is still to be answered.
Thanks so much, Stephen Ahrens, there on this great Big Take story. You can actually, if you're a Bloomberg Terminal customer, just go into NI Big Take and you can find this great story. Every day we put the spotlight on a wonderful story that we talk about often or not, but it's kind of fleshed out in full. Right, we have some breaking news out of the European Union. It's opened Google antitrust probe over some online ad tech. Now, they have investigated or looked into Google in the past. Remember, just I think 2 or 3 weeks ago, they were also looking at Facebook and the likes. We don't know yet exactly what they're targeting or how big the fine could be, but we understand right now that the EU is opening a Google antitrust probe that could frankly last for years over online ad technology. Coming up, more from Bloomberg's Qatar Economic Forum, rethinking the global economic landscape through the lens of the Middle East. Well, the focus, of course, will be on the Boeing chief executive, the Shell chief executive, the Glencore chief executive. I know I'm speaking to Ivan Glassenberg a little bit later on, a rare interview. He's usually pretty feisty, so I'm looking forward to it. This is Bloomberg.
I look at Bitcoin in particular as digital gold. And so if you're going to be long gold, Bitcoin's a better version because it's got the same macro tailwinds, but it's also very early in the adoption curve. Right, people were scared of Bitcoin a few years ago. They've moved into the space, and now hedge funds are okay with it. Real money managers are okay with it. Insurance companies are okay with it. And so you're playing an adoption game and you're playing a macro game. And so I'm still a big buyer of Bitcoin.
Galaxy Investment Partner CEO Mike Novogratz talking his book there at the Qatar Economic Forum, Francine. So he says, I'm in, you should be in too.
Yes, we should be. I mean, Tom's fully invested in Bitcoin. I don't know whether he was on Reddit yesterday or not, trading, day trading. Tom, you really got to stop that. Co-anchor of Bloomberg Surveillance joins us now. I know you're looking forward to, of course, hearing from Jay Powell, and you have great guests coming on.
Well, I'm waiting for Matt Miller to tell me Bitcoin's linked to Brent crude, because that probably makes as much sense as gold. We've got really important guests coming up. Julia Coronado will join us, and Francisco Blanche, not alone, but really assertive, about $100 a barrel Brent. That's a long way from a 75 print this morning as well. And a Honda come by on the equity markets. Mr. Chad of Deutsche Bank as well. And the chart's real simple. You go up to 100, and then what's great, Francine, is you adjust back to $65 a barrel. Up you go to 100, slightly below the average price of 110-ish that we had a number of years ago. And then shale oil comes on, and Blanche makes clear, it's transitory oil. Maybe someday we can have transitory Bitcoin.
Maybe transitory.
I think we've seen that.
What is transitory oil?
Transitory oil is supply and demand has some real malleability here because of the technology of shale. Price goes up and then shale comes on with a vengeance, boosting supply and bringing the price down to $65 a barrel. Blanche has a great phrase, work from car, which is why we're going to go up to $100 a barrel. Things have changed, Francine, and particularly in America, there's going to be a lot of people back in their cars. That's the Bank of America guesstimate this morning.
Yeah, we also spoke to the head of oil at Trafigura. And Tom, I have a great chart which needs the keen treatment, actually looking at Brent crude, the most expensive against the Middle Eastern oil in 21 months as we see the recovery, of course, increase. So, Tom, thank you so much. Arbitrage. Yes. Tom Keane, co-anchor of Bloomberg Surveillance. We have a packed day ahead. I know there's a lot, you know, riding on, of course, politics, finance, and the economy. Kailey, what's on your radar?
Politics, Francine. The New York City mayoral election primary is today. Voters heading to the polls. And, of course, the primary is crucial because whoever emerges as the winning Democratic candidate in all likelihood will become the next mayor of the country's largest city, because this is a city that runs really deeply blue. Brooklyn Borough President Eric Adams could maybe be considered the front runner, but really it's still anyone's race, especially because there is this new system of ranked choice voting at play. So it allows people to select as many as five candidates in order of preference rather than just one. So it'll be very, very interesting to see how these results shake out, Matt.
Can't be as blue as Washington, D.C., right? But I'm watching the nation's capital as Rob Portman, Republican from the great state of Ohio, goes in with a group of bipartisan congresspeople to try and pass an infrastructure deal. We could hear as early as today whether the White House is down to clown or reaffirms its opposition to the group's plan. But we're talking about a much smaller package, less than $600 billion, I think 579. My eyes are glued to NICNG or NIEXE to watch and see if we actually make some ground today.
Yeah, and then NI, of course, US for any stories. You can IB us also on IB plus TV Go. I like
NIUS is such a broad tent. You know, I like broad, to narrow it down a little bit.
Yeah, it depends on who's watching us. Matt, this is what I'm watching. I'm actually watching two things. So first of all, the Qatar Economic Forum. I know there's a great live blog bringing us up to date with all the C-suite that we've been talking to. We've just heard from Michael Novogratz. Of course, Matt Miller brought us that interview, and he said he's still a buyer of Bitcoin and prefers the digital currency to buying gold. I think earlier we also spoke to the Binance Holding chief executive. We heard from Larry Summers. And then later today, we hear from Shell about the energy transition. I'll be also speaking to Ivan Glassenberg of Glencore, one of the rare interviews, and maybe his final interview at Glencore since he's stepping down at the end of June. The other one, and of course, Matt and Kailey, this is the one thing that we've been constantly talking about throughout the markets, is Treasury traders are really looking to Jay Powell to provide some calm after a volatile few sessions that have sent yields on what one bank described as a roller coaster ride. So investors are hoping to get a little bit more clarity when he testifies to the U.S. Congress on the pandemic response and the economy. I don't know if we'll get it, but certainly we've seen some written remarks prepared for the testimony where he was pretty cautious on inflation.
You know what else is very cool, Francine? Farrow is back in the chair. Mm-hmm. So the surveillance team is complete again. John Farrow returns to our airwaves today. I'm very much looking forward to that. I will be watching the next 3 hours of surveillance.
Just
in
time. Yeah, for the UK football game this evening. I don't know if they're doing great, but I know Farrow will be on top of all football news as well. This is Bloomberg.